So, how does this work? Very good. So let me just go back. It's been a crazy year for all of us. And it's been an interesting year. And also, if I look at climate, it's also been a very interesting year. So I'm going to talk about why I think there's a tipping point and why it's been reached. I'll go through this very quickly. So the interesting thing was, first, we start with 2020. It was the hottest year on record. Now, if we look at 2021, interesting was that July was the hottest month on record that we've seen globally. And number two, I think we've seen records right across Europe and North America being broken. I come from Ireland. Ireland is not renowned for its good weather, and it's 28 degrees in Ireland today, right? I mean, it's really quite shocking. Now, if you look at this here, this was in Sicily, and in Sicily, they hit 48 degrees, okay? Now, but it's not just hot weather, because it's extreme weather, right? I live in Germany, and people say to me, how can a flood like this happen in Germany, one of the most advanced countries in the world? Well, then I go and say, well, what about New York last week, right? The whole New York City underwater, right? There's Brooklyn Station, right? So we got extreme weather events really becoming a common occurrence across the world. The other thing, though, is look to 2050. This is the climate model from the Potsdam Climate Institute. And what you see is really the Benelux, a large part of the Benelux underwater, and a large part of northern Germany. Now, you might say to yourself, how the hell are we going to deal with that? Are you going to put a wall in and around that? I'd put money on it that what's actually going to happen is people are going to leave these countries. Because the cost of actually trying to actually deal with that impact in 30 years' time is enormous, right? And we haven't even thought about actually the impacts of climate change and actually how to deal with it. What I would say, though, is that we reached an inflection point. And an inflection point is you can go up or down. And why I say this is, if you look at some of the climate models that are out there, they're saying that we've reached a tipping point. Now, tipping points tend to go down. My own view, actually, is positive. And let me explain why I'm positive about actually climate change and what's happening. The first thing is that people want change. People across the world realize that, hey, there's something happened to our climate and we need to do something about it. And this, by the way, particularly in North America, is very, very important because we had a huge amount of climate deniers in North America. There's a big change also in the United States in terms of their views. The second thing I would say is governments are responding. We're seeing European Green Deal. We're seeing an election here in Germany where really the whole climate is a very, very important part of everything. And then we've got Joe Biden and his $1 trillion Green Deal. Third thing is economic damage is just too great to ignore, right? We just saw what's happened in New York. We see what's happening in West Germany. You look at the losses in this area and you say, actually, we can't deal with the economic impacts of this. I can just say to you, I live in the flood plains of the River Oder. The second this flood hit, I had 2 days later a letter from my insurance company wanting me to upgrade my flood insurance, which I did, okay? It cost me €250 to get flood insurance, right? Okay, normally I pay €200 for my insurance a year. So just give you an idea, right? The insurance companies are saying, hey, we've got an issue here. The fourth thing, which is really gets me positive, is the entrepreneurs are beginning to make money out of this. I lived through Cleantech 1 where nobody made money, right? Solar boom and bust 15 years ago. What you've got now is this man being the richest man in the world. And what he's doing is motivating a whole generation of entrepreneurs to do what he's been doing. The other thing, I come from the finance world, is the finance world has finally woken up to what I call climate risk. What BlackRock are doing is they're knocking on the doors of every single listed company in the world that they are investing in, and they're asking them, have they got a climate plan? And if they don't, they're saying, you need to get one, okay? This has a big impact. But not just that, what I would say to you, and since we last, I haven't had a face-to-face meeting like this in 18 months, the finance world has completely changed, where there's massive amounts of money that now want to go into anything to do with climate technology, right? This we couldn't have done a year ago. I just say that anyone who wants to do something really big in climate, you can now get the money to do so. Let me just talk, though, a little bit about what the path is going forward. How do we do this? Because this is important if you're going to, you know, if you're going to build businesses in this area. This is from the IEA, and what the IEA is saying is what we need to do is get the fossil fuels down, clean electricity up, and energy demand down. Now, you look at what they're saying, they're actually saying that if we do this over the next, 30 years, energy supply in the world will not increase. Now that's not, don't forget, the whole of Africa has to go and, wants to have the same living standards we have. We've got India, et cetera, et cetera. This is what they're coming at. They're saying we won't need to increase energy supply. They might say they're for the birds, but I will just explain why this is the case and how this can happen. And this is very, very important from a strategic level. There's four ways of doing it. If we're going to decarbonize, we need to electrify, we need to renewabilize, digitalize, and efficientize. Now, let me explain what this means. Let me start with electrify. Electricity is the most important energy source we have. I can do without oil and gas. I cannot do without electricity, right? You saw this in Texas in the floods. Nothing works. Your heating system doesn't work if you don't have electricity. You might have gas, but you don't have electricity, it doesn't work. If I look going forward, though, our digital world actually cannot, anything we have cannot survive with it, right? Our whole payment system doesn't work if we don't have electricity. Think of it like that. You can't go into a shop to do anything if there's no electricity. But the other thing that's very important about electricity is it's a highly efficient energy source because you're not creating a massive amount of heat that gets lost. Best example is if I compare a diesel car and an EV car, 3 times the efficiency, right? So this is what, if you electrify something, then you need less energy. Very, very critical point. Third point is the economics of electricity, electrification, are now compelling. Were they not before? This is just an internal combustion engine. Looking in Germany here at prices, if you go electric today, what you're suddenly doing is you've got really, and even though German electricity is very expensive, you still have a cost benefit to immediately going electric on this. Next thing I would say is, and there's a lot of talk about how we could do alternatives to electrification, ultimately, you have to decarbonize hydrofuels. Start with biofuels, can't do it. I could take the whole of Germany here, cover it in rapeseed and still not meet the country's diesel needs. It's not a sustainable long-term solution. Niche market, definitely. I go to e-fuels, well, you have to create the e-fuels. So how do you create it from? You're gonna create it from electricity. That's what you're gonna do with it, right? Right, the bulk of it's going to come for that. So you say, well, why wouldn't I just use that electricity directly rather than indirectly? And the third one, of course, is store it in the ground. Don't get me wrong, we probably will need to store some of it in the ground, but this is a massive, massive challenge to do this, and it's also very, very expensive. So again, you sort of say, well, if I can't decarbonize hydrofuels, I have to do something else with it, and that's why I say electric. The other thing that's really great, gets me excited, is it's a growth opportunity. Because it's a growth opportunity, the entrepreneurs are jumping on and saying, what are we going to do? If I just take this is the EV space. This is on the right-hand side, the listed companies across the world, new startups in the EV area, Tesla, BYD, NIO, Proterra, Arrival, Fisker. Rimac is a Croatian business. Croatia has no whatsoever history in the automobile industry. Companies are present raising 500 million euros, okay? So just, these are serious competitors to the old world. And why are they doing it? Because they're looking at that growth opportunity and saying, we want to have a big piece of it. And that pushes change. Next thing is renewables. If I look in the world today, wind and solar really are the lowest cost ways of producing electricity. Okay, this is from BNEF giving an idea of their numbers. You can see nothing beats it in terms of cost. The other thing, though, that's very interesting, it's a huge growth opportunity, too. Again, this is the IEA. This is the amount of money that we spend every year. About $300 billion a year is spent on building clean energy resources across the world. The IEA says we need to get what's $1.5 trillion by 2030. All right? What an opportunity for the Vestas of this world and on such companies, right? Huge opportunity. And also, the money is there, that's what I would just say to you. The very good news about all of this is that these technologies are easy to deploy. I can set up and I can actually put solar on my roof and install it. Why is this important? Because if you go to Africa, where they don't have electricity and they need to get electricity, they're not going to put in a nuclear power station, guys. It takes them 10, 15 years to do it. They don't have the engineering capability, but they have the capability to do that. They have the capability to connect a battery into that as well, right? So this is very, very important. If we didn't have this type of technology that's scalable, I'd be concerned. The other thing then is we've got costs that are going to continue going down in these two technologies. Wind turbines getting bigger, and solar what you're getting is higher efficiency cells going forward. Again, costs coming down, and it's very, very, again, important because it makes this whole trend cheaper. Next point for me was digitalization. Digitalization, really critical part of this. Why is digitalization important? One, because it's economics. Digitalization is about pushing efficiencies and things, and we need to make sure that this transition is as low cost as possible. We also have to make sure it's easy to use. Energy is complex. Try decarbonizing your home or your building. You can't do it. It's an impossible task, right? So guess what? You bring digital technologies in there, you make it easier. Next point I would say is then it's also very important is how is the flexibility in and around us. What does flexibility mean? We've got intermittent renewables. We need to change the way the power system works. And that means you're putting in batteries. You're making sure that demand side is more flexible, things like that. And you might say, well, what does that mean? What that means is this. If I go and take all these electric cars and put them onto the system, and I've just got a new electric car, it's got a 70 kilowatt hour battery. I've also got a 7 kilowatt hour battery in my home. Well, why wouldn't I use a 70 kilowatt hour battery in the car, right? This requires digital technologies to connect this together, to make sure you're charging at the right time, and to make sure you can use that battery as a resource in your home or in the grid. This is, by the way, is a strategy of Volkswagen going forward. They are going to go into the energy space, right? They see this and they say that is a great opportunity for them. Last point I would say is efficientize. Efficiency is what we need to put. So what do I mean by efficiency? Efficiency means new business models and digitalization again. So I'll give you an example of this. Just take very simple transport. Is if you have vehicles communicating with each other, guess what you do? You get those vehicles moving quicker through the city, which means less emissions and greater efficiency in terms of use of that energy. The second thing I would say to you is this, is that if you think about automation, what does it mean? It suddenly means you can bring the production costs of things down. This has been a very, very important thing, particularly in the solar space, but also in the battery space going forward. You automize more and more of these capabilities and you bring the cost down, make it lower. The third thing I would say to you about efficiency is this, heat pumps. 1 kilowatt hour of electricity and I get 4 kilowatts of heat. You might say, how do you do this, right? People say the efficiency of these things are greater than 100%. Well, the reason is you're taking heat from the ground or actually from the air. Really, really, really interesting. This is the type of solution that we need to do going forward. Finally, what does that mean for us, right? We're here, what does it mean? I just say to you this, that we're gonna change how we build everything in our society over the next 30 years. Building means how we actually how we build our buildings, how we build our cars, huge changes in the way we do this because we have to move away from fossil fuels in the way they're produced to other cleaner sources. Second thing I would say is it's a huge opportunity. The last time that we had a real revolution in the energy and the mobility space was at the beginning of the 20th century. This is when we created GE, Ford, Bosch, all these businesses were created. We're beginning to see this already, guys, today. I told you, we mentioned Tesla, we've got BYD, in the battery space, I've got CATL in China, right? These are the next generation companies that are gonna dominate this space. So it's a great opportunity for us. And I suppose I'd land with you is that you are part of the solution because it's not about relying on governments anymore. It's about really innovation and getting change to take place. At that, I just say to you, enjoy the next 2 days. I really can't wait for it because I've been locked in my little room for the last year and a half like the rest of us. And I'm looking forward to talking to you face to face. Thank you very much.